Alrighty, just a sec. Alrighty, David, it means an awful lot to be chatting with you because you are my favorite driver at Michael Waltrip Racing. You know that?
You didn't have a whole lot to choose from, though, did you? there wasn't many of us.
Oh, yeah, I know what you mean. So, yeah, my first question for this interview is, where are you originally from?
I'm originally from a small town in Florida. It's called Zephyr Hills. Zephyr Hills, Florida is my hometown, and I was born and raised in Florida.
Oh, nice. I'm originally from Estes Park, Colorado. Ever been there?
No, I have not, no.
Yeah, it's basically the town that's the headquarters for the Rocky Mountain National Park.
Okay.
Yeah. So when did you make your first start as a race car driver?
I guess my first actual race outside of go-karts and that sort of thing were probably, I think I had just turned 14, I believe, if I'm not mistaken.
Ah, nice. Pretty cool. What was growing up with NASCAR like in the 1980s?
I really don't know. I wasn't really focused on anything in that involved NASCAR at all. I was trying to be like my father, who was a career race car driver, and just at a somewhat of a local level. So I was never really focused on any NASCAR stuff at all. Ironically, mm-hmm. It just worked out where I got some opportunities to go that route, but it certainly wasn't anything I was focused on. Mm-hmm. I was actually just trying to get to the next race so I could eat, really, because that was how I kind of sort of made my living. Mm-hmm. And so I was just kind of a journeyman kind of race car driver. You know, I'd travel and race, and where the purses were bigger, and like my father. And I wasn't trying to be the next Richard Petty or anything like or Dale Earnhardt. That really didn't concern me. I just wanted to be able to race and race as, you know, as, be a career race car driver, and that was what I was striving to do early on.
Ah, all righty. Who is your biggest racing hero if you had to pick one?
It would be my father, Buzzy Rubin, who was my hero, still is my hero, still races pretty much every weekend almost, or every other weekend in Florida. He's 78 now, so he's been at it a very long time, obviously. And so he's my hero, and pretty much has always been the case, still is.
That's pretty cool. If I had to pick a hero of mine, I would have to say Jamie McMurray and Kyle Larson.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I met both of them at the Cup races a few years back.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah. When did you first meet Darrell Waltrip?
I talked to Darrell Waltrip on the phone long before I ever actually had a chance to meet him. He called me. I was actually doing a couple races for Joe Nemechek at the time, and we were running fairly decent, I would say, in those few races that I ran. And he was forming a new truck team with Toyota at the time, when Toyota was coming into NASCAR, and they were forming a new team, and he basically called me one night at home, just out of the blue, and asked me to, if I would be interested in racing for him. And obviously I jumped at that opportunity. So I up to that point, I'd never met him. I'd never spoke to him. I'd never been within, as far as I knew, I probably was never even in the same state as he was at up until that point.
Interesting. That's really cool. So that's how you got to know Michael Waltrip then as well, from working with Darrell?
Yeah, I work with Darrell, and then by default, I guess Michael was obviously in the mix as well. So, but the first actual interaction I had with anybody with the last name Walker was with Darrell on the phone.
Ah, all righty. What was your reaction to winning the pole at Homestead and finishing fourth?
To be honest with you, it seems like a very, 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 very long time ago. Which I guess it was. I can't really recall that overall feeling, but anytime I did well, I was, obviously very pleased. So I guess I would have to say I was pretty pretty excited about that, especially if it happened early on in my career,
Yeah, for sure. So do you remember what Darrell Waltrip told you after winning Nashville, or do you not remember that?
I don't really remember, other than the fact that he was there that day for the race, obviously. And he was getting ready to. He wasn't actually feeling well. I think he had a cold, he wasn't feeling overly well. So he was actually going to leave early to head home because he didn't feel well. And I remember him telling me that when I got out of the truck, he was telling me how happy he was that he didn't leave. he was pulling. He was on the access road to lead out of the tunnel in Nashville. And he stopped and pulled over and sat there and was watching the last wind down and realized that we had a shot to win. So he figured he better not go anywhere. So he turned around and went back to his parking spot there and waited it out there. And, so yeah, he was happy and I was too that he didn't leave.
Yeah, I bet. So, what was the reason you were paired with Frank Kerr at Michael Waltrip Racing?
Frank was at the time kind of heading up the testing stuff, the testing side of things at Michael Waltrip Racing, and doing things of that nature. So I naturally I was the guy that they used to test because number one, nobody really wanted to do it anyway. Otherwise, they had other things to do besides that. And for me, I was just happy to get behind the wheel anytime I could. So. So I guess they just paired Frank and I because we had worked together and tested together and had a pretty good interaction. Had good interactions with each other, crew chief to driver kind of, so to speak. And I was actually a Frankie Kerr fan back when Frank used to race sprint cars and I was younger. I used to be a fan of his. So it was kind of ironic that I got paired with him, even after the fact. So
yeah, I met Frank a year ago at the Cup race at ISM Raceway, and he was very nice. I like him.
Yeah, he's a good guy for sure.
Yeah, and I interviewed Frank last year through the phone, like I'm doing with you right now, so that was pretty cool as well.
Sure.
Yeah. So what was your reaction when you secured a spot in the Daytona 500 with help from Boris Said?
Leading up to that point, I knew Boris was my overall focus because, I knew if he got in, if he raced his way in, then I was secure in a spot and we were going to be okay. So I was pretty stressed out watching that first segment of the race there, or the first race rather. So I was obviously probably the world's biggest Boris Said fan during that particular time. But yeah, it was a sense of relief because, we were a very, very, very young team and we didn't have a great deal of information or things built up to be as fast as we needed to be right out of the box because of the time frame. So yeah, it was just a sense of relief, the fact that due to him racing his way in, that we were automatically in, and that was a huge, huge weight off our shoulders for sure.
Yeah, I bet. I've always said that 2007 was probably the year that NASCAR was at its pinnacle because anybody could win back then. And, and the road course ringers were good at Sonoma and the Glen. And, it was very competitive. You know what I mean?
Sure. Very, very, very competitive.
Yeah. What exactly happened at Auto Club that caused your accident?
Let's see here. if I'm not mistaken, it was towards the end of the race, and we were just, at that point, we were just in survival mode because we didn't have many cars built up, and we just needed to, number one, first and foremost, make races, and number two, you know, finish races and not tear anything up because we didn't have a large arsenal of cars at that time. And obviously that didn't work out very well, but yeah, I got Greg Biffle got into me getting in a corner and turned me sideways, and I screwed up and kind of overcorrected the thing and drove it, you know, and it snapped around and hit the fence really hard. So yeah, I mean, it was obviously not one of my better memories for sure, but it's just something that happens in racing sometimes. Sometimes when you're really, really trying not to tear anything up, that seems like that's when you tear the most stuff up, it seems like sometimes.
Yeah. That's tough. What was racing the inaugural Busch race in Montreal like that year?
Let's see, was that the year it rained? No, it was not.
No, that was the
second year, I think, right? Second or third year.
Yeah, that was the second year. The first one was when Robbie Gordon got into it with Marcus Ambrose and the controversy.
Oh, yeah, okay. I don't know. I mean, Montreal in itself was a very, very, very cool area. And it was pretty cool to be a part of that deal. I mean, I'm not a huge road course guy, and I'm certainly not so I'm not a huge fan of those anyway. So I would have certainly much rather attended an oval of some sort. But with that being said, it was the environment was cool, and the where the racetrack is and the way it's set up and the fans and all those things. It was really cool.
Ah, that's nice to hear. And what was winning in Memphis like that year in Busch?
That was probably one of my favorite wins of all time, actually, just because of the fact that we were struggling on the Cup side, and we had actually missed the show, if I'm not mistaken, at Atlanta, because we, you know, that was early in the Cup deal, and we still didn't have the speed we needed to make races on a regular basis without having issues sometimes. And so it was cool because I didn't get any practice or anything. I just showed up, got off the plane, the airport, the private airport was right next to the racetrack. So I was able to land there and just kind of basically jump on the golf cart and ride over the racetrack. So I didn't have any practice in the car. My only option was the Martin Green practice for me, and he had a very, very good car, and we were able to take and just show up and qualify only with no practice at all, and I was able to sit on the outside pole. Marcus Ambrose actually, ironically, got the pole, and I got the outside pole. We had a very good car that day, and we just pretty much, despite the 9 million yellows they had during that race, we were able to pull it off, and that was good because it was so good we were obviously struggling on the Cup side, but on the Busch side, I felt like we were very, very good. So sometimes you lose faith in your overall abilities to win races, and it was just nice to be reassured that I could still win races if we could get the right car underneath me.
All righty, that makes a lot of sense. What was the exact reason that you moved from the zero car to the 44 car?
There was a lot that went into that, but it was actually a situation where I think there was some sponsor things that went along with that, and more importantly, it was some point issues, I think, as well. I think I had a certain amount of points, and we needed cars that were kind of locked in the first time part of the year because of the way things were structured. I'm not exactly sure why, 100% why, all the reasons, but it was done internally. It was not something that I was really overly a part of or anything like that, but it just worked out. And at that point, still, I really didn't care what I was racing, if all of those races something anyway.
All righty. What was your reaction to finishing 10th at Charlotte in 2008?
Yeah, I think that was that was a 600, right? If not, was that a 600? That the long race? Was that the?
I think it was the 600, but it was a year before you won.
I always liked. I was encouraged to know that we could, we could weather the storm there, because that's a very, very tough race to run well at, because of the starting in the day and going into the night, and just the overall length of it and everything that goes along with that. So I felt we were always, felt pretty decent at Charlotte off and on. It just, it feels good to have a good finish in front of, your quote unquote hometown crowd. It's nice. It's always nice to run good, but especially at home, it's nice to run good.
Yeah, that's pretty cool to hear. And what was working with Ryan Pemberton like?
I enjoyed my time with Ryan. It was fairly fairly short, so to speak. But I enjoyed working with him. He's a very, very smart guy, very intense guy, make things happen. Actually a type of guy that you want as a crew chief. I enjoyed our time together, and I learned a lot from him. And I think he's, as far as a crew chief goes, I think I still feel like he was always really underrated as a talented guy. He was a smart guy, I just don't ever think he got I don't think he was really at the end of the day, people think about crew chiefs and who's a marquee crew chief, who's a super smart guy, who's this, that, and the other. And I really, really, really feel like he was looked over, for other guys because for whatever reason. But I always felt like he's an extremely intelligent individual and worked very, very hard to make his cars good.
That's really cool to hear, and that's pretty cool. How did you get paired? How'd you get paired with Rodney Childers?
Ryan was had a very, very, very good offer to go to Red Bull Racing, and it was something that he didn't feel like he could turn down. So then I was left with the crew chief, and Rodney was available, and obviously a very smart crew chief as well. I met with him a little bit there, actually met him for breakfast one morning at a Cracker Barrel of all places, and had breakfast I decided at that point that he was the guy that I wanted as my crew chief, and I think he had other offers as well, so he was still going through all that. So but thankfully it worked out. It was a good fit for a little while.
That's good to hear. And how were you able to win that win at the Coke 600 in 2009 exactly?
I just really just lucked into it, get right down to it. We had a decent car. I scuffed the wall with it a little bit, but early on, and it wasn't, we weren't great, but we were still, we were still at that time early in the race, a top 10 car. And I felt like we would have worked on the car. We would have been better. I'm not sure we would have been a winning car, but we would have been, I felt like we had the opportunity to run in the top five. And then when we were just riding around out there and everybody was in front of me, decided they were going to pin it. I think we were maybe running 11th at the time, maybe right in that range. I'm not exactly sure where we were when everybody pitted, but Rodney told me to stay out. So I stayed out because that's what he told me to do. Then we just rode around there and saved fuel as much as we could. Then the rains came at that point, within a lap or so before we went back green. They brought us down pit road, and then that was pretty much it.
That's great to hear. What did Michael Waltrip tell you when you guys hugged after getting the news that you would be declared victor?
Well, he and I talked about, I talked at length about, what would happen if we won that race that day. And, he knew I wasn't overly thrilled with the fact that, winning a race, you're always thrilled to win a race, but obviously it's not the way you want to win one. You want to win one being the fastest and having the best car and doing the best job. And the rain helped us out and got us the win. So I wasn't overly happy with that. I was thrilled to win a race, but I wanted to do it on my own, or with the team rather, not on my own. So he just told me that, you know, that, hey, this kind of stuff happens, and if it goes our way, that you know, need to be excited about it and roll with it, and just understand that I'm not the first guy that's won a Ring Jordan race, and I certainly won't be the last. And that's just the way the rules are written. And so, yeah, I mean, I guess he was getting me ready for the fallout that may happen, because, you know, at that point, everybody tells you, well, you just lucked into it, which, I mean, we didn't luck into it. Rodney just made a very, very good call, and that's what got us the win.
Ah, all right, Ian. That makes a lot of sense. And how were you able to win the second race at Chicago the following year?
Yeah, Chicago is a racetrack that I like a lot. We've been decent there in the past, and we just had a good car. I had a very good car from the time we unloaded till and all night long. And Rodney kept adjusting on the car a little at a time. And fortunately, it didn't need a lot of adjustment, because he brought me a good car to begin with, and we were very good. And I guess really what it comes down to is I did a decent job behind the wheel, and we had a very good car, and those things came together, and we were able to have a really, really good night. That's a win that I'm very proud of, just the simple fact that we outran a lot of really good cars, and you know, we didn't luck in anything. We were just the best car that day, the best team that day.
Yeah, and the fact that you held off Jeff Gordon, that says a lot, you know?
Sure, yeah.
So that's pretty cool. And what was your reaction to finishing second at Bristol a few weeks later?
I think I ran second to Kyle. I was actually aggravated, because I felt like we should have won that race, and we just over adjusted slightly on our last pit stop, and we had the car just a little too tight. Not bad at all, but just all you had to do was be off a little bit to get beat that night by Kyle. I'm certainly happy to run well in races, but with that being said, I was pretty aggravated.
Yeah. And this next one, you don't have to answer if you don't wish, since it's probably not a splendid memory. But what exactly happened between you and Kyle Busch at Kansas that year?
He decided he needed to run over me. So I wrecked him.
Yep. That's a part of the sport, you know. Yep.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's one of those situations where he wrecked me, and he did it on purpose, and I wrecked him back, and, you know, we carried on our merry way. Was not a big deal, so.
Yeah. That's just what happens in sports like that. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Yeah. Jack Baldwin, a race driver I interviewed a few weeks back, he's a Trans Am driver, and he told me a similar thing. So, yeah, it's just a part of the sport.
Yeah.
Which wreck, in your opinion, was worse between Auto Club and Watkins Glen in 2011?
Obviously, both of those wrecks were noteworthy, but I really, really felt like my worst accident that I've had was in the Truck Series at Texas. I think, yeah, that stands out as one of my most that's the one that took me the longest to recover from. So that's just why I go off of that. The way it was, Texas is a very fast racetrack, and we just got tore up there and wrecked and. Those obviously, the Auto Club race wreck and the Watkins Glen wreck were probably some of the more popular ones, because they got shown on TV more. But the truck race at Texas was probably, I feel like, was my worst one.
Yeah, I might need to look that one up. Yeah.
Sure.
Did Boris Said ever reach out to you after causing the Glen accident, or no?
No, I never did. I never did hear from Boris on that front.
Yeah, I heard he had a feud with Biffle afterwards, and that might have been what he was focused on for a while.
Probably so. Yeah.
Yeah. What was your reaction to winning the pole at Richmond in 2011?
I think I think we were pretty pumped up about that. I mean, I think we had a little bit of a dry spell there, and we actually weren't. I didn't feel like running up to our potential at all, and we'd had some good races, but not anything I would consider great. And so, be able to get that pole was, felt like it. You know, it was definitely timed well. We needed that little bit of a boost. You know.
Yeah. And what was the exact reason that you departed the team at the end of the year?
Departed Michael Watch Racing?
Yeah.
Oh, I got fired.
Oh, that's it?
Yep.
All righty. Makes sense. And what was working with Tommy Baldwin's team like?
I enjoyed my time with Tommy. I know we didn't run well at all, but as you know, Tommy was a very small independent guy with a very, very, very small budget, and so yeah, I mean we didn't run well, but I enjoyed Tommy. Tommy's an interesting guy, and I enjoyed my time with him.
Yeah, pretty cool. And what was working with BK Racing like?
It was another situation where they didn't. There were some good guys over there, some good people, and I think they had the right intentions and tried to make things happen and tried to do the best with what they had, but they certainly didn't have the financial backing that they needed, it's one of those situations with any team that doesn't have the financial backing, you're going to struggle, and we struggled. And it was some good people, some very good people, some nice people, some people I enjoyed spending time with. But as far as the results go, there really weren't any.
Yeah. What was working with Pat Friesen like on the team?
I enjoyed Pat is a good guy. I enjoyed another guy I feel like is vastly underrated. I enjoyed my time with Pat. Really good guy. Tries really, really hard. Puts a lot of effort in. Neither one of us was in a very good situation. And we just were trying to make the best out of it, you know?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And good on you to do that, you know?
We're both in the same similar situations. We both had been with bigger teams and had some success in different areas, and that just wasn't the situation we were in at that time, so we just both made the best of it, you know?
Yeah. What was working with Front Row Motorsports like for those few races the following year?
Yeah, it was, you know, again, a good group of people, but not anything that had any kind of results. And it was just at that point in my life, I can't remember how old I was at that time, but I had to have been mid-40s, I would say, at that time. And, it was just time. I had a decent career, and it was just time to go do something different. So,
yeah, makes sense. What's your favorite racing movie between Days of Thunder and Talladega Nights?
Let's see. I like Talladega Nights just because it's supposed to be goofy and ridiculous, and not that I'm not a fan of Days of Thunder. I'm just I just always chuckle at the fact that in Days of Thunder, if you want to pass a guy, all you got to do is shift from third to fourth and mash the pedal down a little farther. You can just drive right around them. That always interested me. How they get to take things like that. Where Talladega Nights is just supposed to be funny and make you laugh and goofy, and I enjoy that aspect of it.
Yeah, and I always liked the bad guy of that film, Jean Girard. He was pretty funny.
Yeah.
So, what are you doing these days now that your NASCAR career is over?
I'm building dirt cars, which is where my background was originally early on in life. I built dirt cars for here in North Carolina, and just doing that, staying very, very, very busy with that stuff, and having a good time doing it.
That's great to hear. And this is the last question on my list. And if you don't have any answers, I understand. But is there anyone you can think of that might be willing to do chats with me like this in the future that I could reach out to, or no?
I'm not really sure. I mean, I've certainly lost contact with people, but I do know that there's some really good guys. I don't know if you've ever talked to, say, for instance, Michael McDowell. He's a kind of an under the radar kind of guy, but he's a very good guy. Other than that, I'm not off the top of my head. I'm not really sure who's open to that sort of thing, really.
Yeah, I kind of thought you would say that, because you know. But no problem. I can probably reach out to McDowell through his team, Front Row Motorsports. Know what I mean?
Yeah, and I'm quite sure Michael's also on Facebook, if I'm not mistaken. So you could probably nail him down there on something as well.
Yeah, for sure. I'll try that. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Have a good day.
You Bye. Too. Have a good one.
Bye.
Bye. All righty. That worked out pretty good. Yep. Worked out pretty good. I love it.